Faith Community Church. Thank you for tuning in today, and I hope that even amidst the current circumstances, your Easter morning is going very well. Happy Resurrection Sunday to you, and as we say in the church, He is risen indeed. As a matter of fact, this morning I would like to start with a reading from Matthew chapter 28. If you would like, you could go ahead and turn there with me. The text of our sermon this morning will be coming from Romans chapter 8. So if you'd like to go ahead and mark that in the meantime, that will be fine as well. But specifically this morning, I want to begin by reading what happened on that glorious Sunday morning when they went to the grave to prepare the body of Jesus Christ. Matthew 28. Now, after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen. As he said, come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead, and behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy, and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up to him, and they took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to him, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." Before we begin the sermon this morning, again, Romans chapter 8, let's just start with a word of prayer. Lord, we know that you are good. We know that you are present. We know, Lord, that through the resurrection of Jesus Christ and through his righteousness, we have peace with you. And I pray, Father, that you would open our mouths this morning, our hearts this morning, our minds this morning, that we may love you with all of them, that we may be willing to spread your word all around this world, both through our lifestyles and through our words. We pray this morning, Lord, that you would just bless the hearers, bless me as I speak your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All around the world, Sunday morning, we're waking up in Eastern Standard Time. The Easter celebration has been going on for hours and will continue to go on for hours as people begin waking up at the earliest of dawn to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Today I want to look at what the new life in the Spirit, what the resurrection means for us as believers, as Christians, as followers of him who was raised from the grave, and what it means to have the same power living and dwelling in us. So turn with me to Romans chapter 8, and let us begin. I'm going to read through the text, and then I'll go back, and we'll just kind of unpack some things. "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin he condemned sin in the flesh. Verse 4, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on flesh is hostile toward God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if, in fact, the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Backing up to verse 1, there's a lot to unpack in this few 11 verses, and truly more than we could possibly unpack this morning, but I just want to get sort of an overview of this text in. Now, therefore, whenever you see therefore, it's important to ask, what is therefore therefore, right? Therefore is a conclusion of something, or a result, a consequence, if you will, of something that has happened before. If we back up to chapter 7, verse 22 through 25, for I delight in the law of God. Understand that the law of God was good. God did not make anything that was not good. The earth he made, it was good. The human body he made, it was good. The law he made, it was good. It was man's rebellion of the law which caused sin to enter in. But it wasn't the law that wasn't right. It wasn't the law that wasn't good. It wasn't the law that was inadequate, but my flesh, based on my desires and my temptations. But I see, he says, verse 23, in my members another law, waging war against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am. So because this law, which is good, but me, which is not good, I cannot maintain and follow that law good enough, well enough, perfect enough. As a matter of fact, the Bible says to offend in one point is to make you guilty of the whole law. You can't just throw a pebble into the lake and it affect one small part just where the pebble drops, but it ripples out and you can see the effects of that going on and on and on. Sin has effects on others. Wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Christ Jesus our Lord. So in 8 verse 1, and therefore there is now no condemnation. When he's talking about therefore, he's talking about this victory that is in Jesus Christ. If you look back at chapter 7 and verse 6, but now, we have that same word over here in chapter 8, verse 1. Therefore, now, but now, chapter 7, verse 6, we are released from the law, having died to that which has held us captive, so that we serve in the new way of the Spirit, and not in the old way of the written code. Now, this links us back to chapter 5 and verse 1. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, chapter 5, verse 1 is going to link us back to the implications of the introduction that Paul gave in chapter 1, verse 16 and 17. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. So we have this introduction of what faith is, what faith looks like, and why and how not to be ashamed of it, and how the righteous will live by it. The problem is I'm not wholly righteous, but Jesus is wholly righteous. So it's my faith in him that creates peace with God. And that peace with God gives me the victory. Now, because of those things, there is therefore no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Condemnation, if you look back at chapter 7 and verse 10, the very commandment that promised life proved to be death to me. And it wasn't because the law was bad, because I was bad. The law was good. Anything God created is complete and whole and good and needs no mankind alteration. But the law, I was not able to fulfill the law. But Jesus was able to fulfill the law. He was the one who the law anticipated. He was the one who came and lived the perfect life, the sinless life. And he was the one who was the willing sacrifice, the blood atonement for the sins of the whole world, which we'll get into a little bit more in the text. For those who are in Christ Jesus is sort of a parenthetical statement here in chapter 8, verse 1. Verse 2, for the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus. Now, this is, of course, figuratively, but I want to unpack it a little bit. To remove the restrictions of sin, the restrictions of darkness, because we've been delivered by God into true spiritual liberty and growth. You remember John chapter 8, verse 36 says, in whom the Son sets free is free indeed, and free wholly, free completely. If you look at that a little bit deeper, if we were to translate it a little bit more, whom the Son releases from darkness is released from the obligations of darkness, and thus free to grow and to realize, to make real one's true identity in Christ. You see, a seed is a potential of what is possible. I've mentioned it before, but there is an acorn, which is a very small, compared to other seeds, it's quite large, but compared to the oak tree, it's extremely small. This tiny, tiny seed, if it stays a seed, obviously will never reach its full potential. But if this seed is released from just being a seed, if it's released from the boundaries of just being a seed, if it's released from, to use the metaphor, the darkness, it then can grow into a very, very large tree that's able to produce millions and millions of seeds, and in each and every seed, you have more millions and millions of trees. We're not intended as children of God to walk in darkness, to walk in ignorance, to walk in shame, to walk in guilt, to walk in those things, to walk in hiding. As a matter of fact, in John chapter 3, verse 16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And verse 19 says, and this is the judgment. Light has come into the world, and people love the darkness rather than the light because their works were evil. The only reason to stay in darkness is to continue evil works. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his work should be exposed. But whoever does what is true comes to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in God. Back to Romans chapter 8, verse 2. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law. Now the law employs, sin employs the law for its own purpose. So the law says this thing is sin, and then sin says, I'm going to make you people do these things, and when you do them, you're going to want to stay hidden. You're going to want to stay in darkness, because to come out of that is going to bring shame and guilt, as I mentioned already. That is not the purpose of God. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, not the law's fault, but by my flesh's fault, could not do, what was impossible to be done, by sending, how did he do it? By sending his only Son, his own Son, in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh. Now, if you look back in verse 1, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And then link that to verse 3 here. Because he came in the likeness and overcame sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. Let's unpack that a little bit. So, by one's good example, it renders another's wickedness more evident and more reprehensible. why was Noah, let me back up. Think about Noah. He was a preacher of righteousness, the Bible says. By him building an ark, he condemned the world's wickedness. By finding favor with God, and God saying, Noah, I'm going to cause it to flood. I'm going to kill off everybody. You need to build an ark. As people are coming by, he's saying, well, God told me to build this ark because he's going to flood the world because you're all in wickedness. By building the ark and obeying God, he's exposing the darkness of the people that are around him. And by living this perfect, sinless life through his son, who partook of human nature, but was without sin, God deprived sin, which is the grounds for condemnation. He deprived sin of its power in human nature. He broke down its deadly sway. Just as a condemned person, just as a condemnation and punishment of a wicked person might put an end to their wicked deeds. So, for example, if somebody's a thief and that person goes to jail, now they are in bondage and chains, if you will. They're not able to go and do these things anymore. Here is the image. Jesus Christ came down. Sin had control over man. Jesus came as a man, and as a man, he conquered. He did not allow sin to penetrate him, but rather overcame sin. And in overcoming sin, causes sin to lose its power over man. That's why in Jesus Christ, there is now therefore no condemnation, because he, in his flesh and in his body, through his sacrifice, condemned sin. Why? In order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled. There was a righteous requirement. You have to obey all of these things. To offend in one point is guilty of all. Nobody could carry out the law completely except Jesus Christ. And when he did, the righteous requirement of the law was fulfilled. Who walk in us now, because we're in him, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. How is the righteous requirement of the law carried out in Jesus Christ, through Jesus Christ in us? It's by us walking according to the, not walking according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Now he's going to unpack that a little bit. Paul here is in verse 5. He's going to tell us what it means to walk in the flesh and walk of the Spirit. And the idea is of a mindset. So you read the words here, set their minds. The idea is a mindset. Remember in Colossians 3:1, it says, if you are risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Set your mind on those things which are above. It's a mindset. For those who live according to the flesh, set their minds on things of the flesh. Now, flesh is not always bad. The word flesh is used in the physical relationship between a husband and wife. The word flesh is used in the sense of Jesus having a physical body, even though there would be some who would say, well, he only appeared to have a physical body. He didn't actually have a physical body. He just looked like he did, which is absolutely false. The flesh, the physical body, is necessary to live out the faith the Lord works in. So in Galatians 2, verse 20, it says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, so I've been put to death with him, yet still my body is alive, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. It's not me anymore, but it's his presence in me through which I live and through which I move and through which I do all things. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. When we're talking about flesh here, we're talking about this independence from God's working. The idea of the flesh is by definition displeasing to the Lord. Even things which seem respectable to us can still be displeasing to God. For there is a way which seems right to man, but the end thereof is the ways of are the ways of death. Flesh here in this context relates to the unaided human effort, trying to do it without God, trying to go my own way, my own will, my own direction, regardless of what God says that we must do. This is carnal. It is of the flesh, and it proceeds out of the untouched, unchanged, untransformed life. It's that part of us that has not been touched by God, that has not been anointed by God. The word anointed meaning smeared, not just a drop here, a drop there, but completely covered, completely smeared. But those who live according to the Spirit, those who live according to that which is which Christ followed and which aided Christ in his ability to overcome sin and overcome the evil one and overcome the world, that which gave him the strength to persevere and to press on even in the midst of those who were scorning him and mocking him and laughing at him and crucifying him, even in the midst of those who he had healed and who he had saved and whom he had delivered, even those people on that day, just a couple of days ago, we memorialized this, that Good Friday where they were yelling, "Crucify him, crucify him." Even in the midst of all that, the Spirit of Jesus Christ, if it dwells in us, then we will set our mind on things of the Spirit. And to set your mind on the flesh, verse 6, is death. But to set your mind on the Spirit is life and peace. Why? Because to say the flesh is going to die. The flesh is continually dying. And we can do a lot of good things. We can eat well, exercise right. We can get good sleep at night. We can do things to help our physical life have a better life. We can do things to maybe prolong our life. But eventually, so goes the way of all men. Unless Jesus returns beforehand, we will all die. We will all pass from this life. We'll all be buried in the ground or cremated one day. For it is appointed unto man once to die. That's the physical man. But the Spirit of Jesus Christ, when we take on his word and take on his life, if we were to go back and read chapter 6 here, it talks about how when we were baptized into his death, we were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, and our spirit then died, and we, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too walk in this newness of life. Corinthians talks about how we're a new creation. Now, in Christ Jesus, the old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. I am something different, and that difference provides life and peace. Verse 7, for the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. Can you imagine being God's enemy? Imagine what it must be like to be God's enemy. The Bible says, God before you, who can be against you? It doesn't matter if it's you and God alone, you make the majority. It doesn't matter if millions and millions and millions of people are walking the other way. If you're standing over here and you're alone with God, you are the majority. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. I wouldn't want to be God's enemy. For it does not submit to God's law. Remember, it's not sanctified by his law. It's not transformed by his word. It's not touched by his spirit. It's a self-will, pride, ego thing that maintains a fleshly walk and not a spiritual presence. Those who, verse 8, are in the flesh cannot please God. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Let's talk about the control by the Spirit here in the latter part of this pericope, this passage. You, however, are not in the flesh. Now we're going to come back to those who, again, who have As verse 1 says, for those who are in Christ Jesus, that's who we're talking about now. For you, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If in fact, since in fact, the Spirit of God dwells in you, lives in you. Understand, this word dwell does not mean just a visitor. The Holy Spirit cannot be a weekend visitor. Okay, we can't build a, pardon the terminology here, but we can't build a mother-in-law suite for the Holy Spirit and say, you know what, you can stay out here in this special place. Yeah, come and join us for dinner from time to time if you need something. You know, that you're welcome to that too. Just be sure you knock on the door and wait for us to come, because I don't want to be interrupted by your inconvenience and by your uncomfortable presence in my life. Now, I know that you bring comfort, but some of the things that you lead me to do, Holy Spirit, I'm not that comfortable with. Listen, the Holy Spirit cannot be a weekend visitor. Shows up one Sunday morning for a couple of hours and then disappears for the rest of the week. This is of the flesh. This is not dwelling. This is not taking up residence. This is not it's not a habitation. Excuse me here. Dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to Him. And here in verse 9, you have Spirit of God and Spirit of Christ represented. It's just showing that they share the same status here. Remember that Jesus did not maintain that His status and equality with God a thing to be grasped, but released Himself of that, made Himself into the image of man, and took on the form of a servant, even to the death of the cross. In verse 10, but if Christ is in you, although your body is dead, although the body is a corpse, no longer susceptible to impulse, if you will, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Now, I want to unpack this a little bit as well. It's not the same. Some people will say that the Holy Spirit and Jesus Christ are the same, but they're not the same. They work cooperatively, and since the bodies of Christians are not yet redeemed, they still die. So the body is not redeemed. The Spirit is redeemed. The Spirit is made new, but the body, you know, you've still got this same old body. You become a Christian, you get a new spirit. You don't get a new body. The body's not redeemed, they still die, even though they're freed from the condemnation of sin. Yet, in the presence of the Holy Spirit within believers testifies to the new life they enjoy because of the righteousness of Christ that is now there. So, when I took on Jesus Christ, my body would still be the same. I might still look the same to outsiders. But on the inside, I'm completely new, completely different, something entirely changed. Now I bear fruit that is not of the flesh, but is of the Spirit. Now it's no longer these sinful nature things that I follow, but now it's peace, love, joy, all of the things of the Holy Spirit. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. And again, not even my own righteousness, but the righteousness of Jesus Christ, through whom I have faith, thus peace with God. If the Spirit of Him, and here's the culmination of all of this, here is where it's so powerful, here is where, this is one of my favorite verses. If the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead, if the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead now lives in you, dwells in you, resides in you, inhabits you, doesn't just show up from time to time, but is a permanent, constant, consistent, continuous presence, He who raised Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who dwells in you. Now, I want to talk about life for a moment. There is, of course, the resurrection. There are two resurrections. And if you were to look in John chapter 5, you could read about these two resurrections. In John chapter 5 and verse 25, the Bible says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, an hour is coming and is now here, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live." Now we're talking about spiritually dead, because if they were physically dead, they wouldn't be able to hear. There's some spiritually dead who will now hear, and because they hear, because they listen, because they follow, they will live. "For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son also to have life in himself." Who gives God life? Who gives Jesus life? They give life. They're the source of life. They're not the product of life. They're the source of it. They're the ones who give us life. Jesus said, "I came to give you life and that you might have it more abundantly." We're going to get to that in a moment. "And as he has given him authority to execute judgment, because he is the Son of Man, do not marvel at this, for an hour is coming when all who are in the tombs," now we're going to move over to those who are dead. So we just talked about the live, those who hear. Now there's coming a time when all that even are in the graves will hear his voice and come out, those who have done good to the resurrection of life and those who have done evil to the resurrection of judgment. There are two resurrections mentioned here. So when we read life over in chapter 8, verse 11, we're reading an eternal perspective, no doubt. But we're also reading a current perspective, a life perspective. There he talks about those who hear his voice now will live. Something happens inside me. Whenever I hear the word of God, I read the word of God, I listen to the voice of God, and maybe something that, how would I explain this? Something resurrects within me. The Spirit of Christ empowers, emboldens, provides faith, provides strength. Something happens inside me spiritually when I follow the Word of God. If I follow the flesh, nothing happens. But when I follow the Spirit, He gives life. So yes, there is eternal life to those who are in Christ Jesus. But there's also life now. There's peace now. There's joy now. I want to read this one last time, this verse. "If the Spirit, since the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you." Now, in order for the resurrection of Jesus to do us any good, we have to receive the Spirit of God into our lives, into our heart. To be a Christian is to be led by the Spirit. And I want to give you, before I close, three evidences of being, of having the Holy Spirit, being led by the Spirit. And this is actually tracing us backwards through the text, and it would be beginning in verse 15. But since we're not actually going to be looking at that this week, I just want to get a head start, get ahead of that. In verse 15, it says, "For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father." If you can cry, Abba, Father, then you have the witness of the Spirit. Verse 14, tracing back here, "For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God." So if you are led by the word of the Holy Spirit, if you are led by the Spirit of God, not by the flesh, not by man, but by God, then you can say you have the Holy Spirit. And then verse 13 here, "For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if you live according to the Spirit, you put to death the deeds of your body, you will live." How do we respond to impulse? How do we respond to the sinful nature? Do we consistently give into it and allow it to control our lives? Or do we turn back to the Holy Spirit? Do we turn back to God and say, "Lord, this is tough for me. I need some help. I'm struggling here, and what I need is some strength. Maybe I find some counsel in godly people as well." But the reality is, do I put to death the deeds of the Holy Spirit? We have the Spirit and the promise of resurrection. Not just eternally, but today, right now, in Jesus' name. Romans chapter 8, verse 11, as I read, if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give life to you. We could go and we could look at Romans chapter 8, verse 23, and see how the first fruits of adoption by God is the presence of God's Spirit in our lives. And the completion of our adoption is the redemption of our bodies one day. We could look at 1 Corinthians 15:44 and see that when our body is raised from the dead, it will be a new spiritual body. Now, some of us are really, really happy about that because, you know, we're not too happy about the bodies we have because they just, they're physical. They get weak. They get frail. You could look at Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and look at the digression of the body over the period of life and how it just suddenly seems to be out of control one day. I was getting up off the floor the other day playing in summer and I heard my knees just start cracking. It sounded like a snap, crackle, pop bowl of cereal, you know? And I asked Tina, I was like, did you hear that? I don't think she heard it, but I sure heard it and I sure felt it. A new body would be great, but a new spiritual body is even greater. Not a mere bodiless spirit, not a mere flesh and blood, but a new body like Christ's body. Remember, they didn't even recognize him on the road to Emmaus after his resurrection. Perfectly suited for constant spiritual fullness and for life in a new heaven and a new earth. And then we can also look at Romans chapter 6 and verse 5 and see how the Spirit secures our resurrection by uniting us with Christ. That verse says, if we have been united with him in a death like his, that's right after our baptism, we're buried with him in baptism, raised to walk in a new life. If we've been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. This morning, we have a new life in Jesus Christ. Because of what he's accomplished, because of his victory over sin, and because of his victory over the grave. Now, we have that same Spirit that raised him from the dead, that miraculous event that changed the entire history and the entire future, the one moment that changed everything, we have that living in us. The question is, what are we going to do with that power? What are we going to do with that boldness? What are we going to do with that transformation? Are we going to walk after the flesh? Are we going to walk after the Spirit? The Spirit gives life. The flesh leads to death. Let's pray. Merciful and mighty Jesus Christ, we turn from guilt, shame. We trust in the provision of your forgiveness. We turn from sin and darkness and trust the new path for our life. We turn from self-reliance and pride and trust your power to help us obey. We turn from fear, doubt, shame, worry, anxiety, depression, and we trust in your promises for our future. We love you. We thank you for the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, which lives in us and enables us to be sons of God, daughters of God, and to walk out this life in faith, trust, hope, and love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Happy Easter, everyone. He is risen indeed.